calling it the Athletic
Pinnacles. Pinnacles.
Yeah, so it's going to be a good show. Just want to say that we are on, if you want to see any of our articles and any stories that we're doing and any shows we're doing, you can go to njdiscover.com, like us on Facebook and Instagram. And we just want to say we are in Princeton. So we're Princeton TV, Long Branch, Old Bridge, North Brunswick, U-town, yourtowntube.com, Rutgers TV, YouTube, and Marlboro. So thank you for all those towns for carrying our show. And I'm going to turn over to Calvin. Calvin, tell us a little bit about what we're doing here, because this is going to be a really good show.
It's really, it's an amazing show with Greg Valentine, Chris Mirabelli, Casey Murphy, how this all came about. And when we're done with a little monologue, see, my hands are moving. I have to keep them under the table. My hands move all over. You noticed that.
Yes.
My hands move all over the place. So they're under the table. I can't control myself.
You want to tell us what you've been doing? What
have you as I'm looking at these two Rutgers graduates over here. So it's a long story. And actually, it really became official because the Rutgers sent a photographer. I didn't even tell you guys. Rutgers sent a photographer in to document my being a teacher.
Ah.
So I am now... my title is professor. Don't you laugh over there. By the way, I have to acknowledge our studio audience, Kenneth Beckerman, Darren Antola, David Wilkins, and we'll talk about how you guys were so instrumental in getting this show here. It's a long, long, laborious story.
But you're a professor. Do you wear your hat while you teach?
You bet I do. You bet I do. It does not come off. So in August, Rutgers University called me. I did not solicit. And a professor asked if I would be interested in teaching a career explorations course. Mm-hmm. And it's been a long journey. Do I do this? Am I absolutely insane to do this at this... As a septuagenarian, I'm looking at you, Greg. because, you know, we're septuagenarians.
Sure. Yes, we are.
So, as a septuagenarian, do I want to take this on when I could be... The truth is, I should be, and I could be, sitting on my front porch in a rocking chair, drinking prune juice on the rocks.
Sure.
You're not that old, Calvin.
Old enough. So, why would I want to give up the prune juice and start teaching? Anyway,
it's a lot to share.
Anyway, Monday, I actually soloed in front of my class with 21 kids. I solo the Professor Cleary, who was our guest 6 weeks ago.
6 weeks.
Yes, she's been sitting in to kind of get me into the groove here. So she thought I'm ready to take it upon myself. And Monday I soloed, and today, so I'm a professor.
You're officially a professor.
Yes. So that's.
We should, from now on, I'll introduce you then as Professor Calvin.
And actually, I asked a lot of people, and I should talk to you later. I mean, what do people call me? You know, without. You know, being nasty over there. No, I mean, I don't know. Everybody calls me Calvin. People can start calling me Professor. But enough with me.
I like it. I'm going to call you Professor from now on.
You may.
Thank you.
You absolutely may. and I'm just thrilled for you to share with what's going on with you.
Yeah.
No, thrilled. And tomorrow night is a highlight for me to be there. And share that with you. So why don't you...
I've been working on a story for probably 10 years. And it's so I've made it into a sitcom. I have a really great writer, Keith
Arminitis.
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 It's such a strange name, but he's awesome.
Yes.
And he wrote out what I had created and created a short film or sitcom. So we're going to have a table read tomorrow, and we have a great actress, Claudia Wells, who's going to read with us, and Joe Bonanno, who is also a performer, and Brianna Eve, and she's an actress in New York.
Michael T.
And Michael Toda.
Yes.
Yep. So we have a lot of really good people reading, and it's going to be exciting. We'll see if it gets picked up in sitcom, so you heard it here, Rack.
It's wonderful.
All right, let's bring on our guests.
Okay, so real quick, how did this show came about? I think it's fabulously interesting.
Mm-hmm.
We part of this began with David Wilkins and LinkedIn, which I love. LinkedIn, He's a Rutgers guy. I'm a Rutgers guy. We got connected, and boom, boom, boom. We did an interview on NJ Discover, and then you were guest with Tito Santana. With this, I can't show this enough, because you guys were the producer of 350 Days. Mm-hmm. Greg Valentine was a star in this. Mm-hmm. A Most Amazing, which is available on Amazon Prime right now, on demand, a cable. What a marvelous, amazing, sensitive, magnificent movie. I've watched it for the fourth time today. It's just a human insight. But anyway, all of that well-being and all of that stuff was born, and that gave the impetus. And then more LinkedIn. As I look at Chris Mirabelli, I sent you a LinkedIn invitation. Yep. And you connected with me, and then I looked at your profile, and I'm kind of a groupie. I see a four-time Rutgers Javelin All-American.
Yep.
Boom. And that little innocent connection led to a couple of messages, which led to a phone call.
To a long phone call.
Long phone call. I guess I do long phone calls. There's no short with me. And then you sent me your story, which we'll talk about shortly. Mm-hmm. And then we met at Henry's Diner.
Henry's.
And there's a great story about Chris and his journey, which we'll talk about on njdiscover.com. Mm-hmm. And here we all are. And then, of course, getting Greg in the availability and talking to Darren and David, boom, what a great show. And, of course, through you, met Casey. And I'm not just saying this because you're sitting here, but I'm a huge fan of Rutgers soccer, and I can prove mm-hmm. it. And we didn't even talk about this, but NJ Discover, for 2 years, used to broadcast Sky Blue.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow.
You didn't know that. We did... 2 years, mm-hmm. we were the broadcast arm of Sky Blue.
Wow.
So I'm running around the field pretending I'm important with a camera. And so I have a great affinity for women's soccer, as we talked about. Anyway, that's how the show came about. So, you know, putting Greg and Chris and Casey together as athletic pinnacles, it kind of worked out. So that's that.
Mm-hmm. So we're going to turn it over to you guys. If you can do just a short bio, and maybe if you want to do some contact information, where people, if they want to follow your career. So we can start with Casey Murphy.
Hi, my name is Casey. I'm 23 years old. I went to Bridgewater-Raritan High School. I played soccer there for 4 years on the varsity team. And my senior year, we won a state championship. I then moved on to play at Rutgers, where I was a student athlete. I played there 3 years. And left a year early to go play professionally, follow my dream, and play in France, where I played in the French League for 2 years. There I was able to see the field, experience a different culture, learn a lot about myself and how much I love the sport, and eventually make a name for myself, winning French Goalkeeper of the Year. With that success, I was able to come back and play in the States. Now I play for Rain FC in Washington State, right by Seattle, and yeah, I'm happy and excited about the future of my journey.
That's awesome.
Great. That's a good bio.
Yeah, really like, good.
Oh, it's wonderful.
As it was scripted.
It's wonderful.
Wow, well done.
They just threw the bio on me 2 minutes ago. So.
My name is Chris Mirabelli. I am currently a professional javelin thrower. Not many people know of that, or that you could throw professionally in javelin, but born and raised in South Jersey, went to Rutgers University on the track and field team. I was captain for 2 years. I was leaving Rutgers in the NCAA, I was a four-time All-American, three-time Big Ten champion, a junior Pan American gold medalist for Team USA. I was currently in my master's program finishing global sports business, and just training professionally now, preparing for my upcoming season. For both of our goals to be in the 2020 Olympics together would be pretty awesome as well. But that's pretty much my story right now. That's what I got going on.
Okay. That's great.
Greg Valentine.
Well, my journey is a long journey. I started wrestling when I was 1970 I started wrestling. So, and professional wrestling, and got my really first big break in 1976 in the NWA and the Mid-Atlantic area, and actually came into, it was WWE now, but it was WWF back then in 1979, and came in and had very, very good success in WWF. Was put in the Hall of Fame in 2004. And when you're in the Hall of Fame, you're supposed to quit wrestling, but I kept on wrestling. In fact, I just wrestled last week in Wichita, Kansas. So I still like to get in the ring. I'm still in pretty decent shape, you know.
That's
great. Like to take those young kids and knock them around, smack them around. Because, you know, it's not all about being, you know, in great physical shape. It's about right here, the brains know how to cut the corners. But I'm really joking when I say that, because a big kid like this would probably kill me. But I'm like a kid still up here, because the business I am, you know, I guess you just can't mature very much. I'm still a kid at heart, and I loved what I've done, and I still like what I'm doing, and I'm got a book coming out, and also this great movie, 350 Days, that I'm in, and a lot of my other colleagues. So, yeah, there we go.
Did you really wrestle last week?
Yeah. And Salinas, Kansas. Salinas, just north of Wichita.
you wrestled.
Yeah, that just blew me away when you said that. Wow, yeah. I didn't even realize.
Yeah.
Wow.
Did you win?
Oh, of course. I wrestled some 20-year-old millennial or whatever. Slapped him around.
That's almost me.
Slapped him around, put the figure four on him.
It's a two-hour segment. Second hour is him wrestling you.
I loved reading and studying about you, because I did that. Of all there's so many wrestlers who all have gimmicks, but you were gimmick free,
yeah,
which is just wonderful. And that's a perfect segue for me to ask you the first question. Mm-hmm. Jump right into that.
Gimmick free, okay.
Well, I always love segues. Well, anyway, we talked about it before. You know, people, you know, there's so many misconceptions about wrestling, and I said, from everything I've learned and from 350 days and everything listening and learning from this, because I grew up and I showed you that program. I mean, that was the biggest night of the week when I was able to go to a wrestling match in Newark. But what I gleaned in part from the movie is you guys are really athletes and you're actors. You're an amazing combination of both.
Yeah.
But can you just give a little picture of the training that you did? Because it had to be fairly intense. And it's probably still, I mean, you still work out, eh?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Well, I enjoy working out, but it's called a maintenance workout now.
Okay.
Or rehab.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
I call it rehab.
Hey, that's very funny. That's really very funny.
When I walk to the mailbox, it's rehab. So walking through the airports, it's rehab. This is good for me. Even when I was a young kid, I hated to walk. Uh-huh. And I hate to run, but I could wrestle out there 60 minutes every night against Bob Backlund or Hulk Hogan, but he never went that long. But, you know, I love it. I love the wrestling. And something happened to me when I crawled in between the ropes and got in there. I thought I was Johnny Valentine, who's the greatest wrestler of all time, and that's my dad. And so it's just, yeah. What was the question again?
I forgot.
But, yeah, it's been a great journey for me.
But basically, you really had, and still do, and forgetting the rehab, it's work.
Yeah.
It's work.
Yeah, well, I worked out with weights, but I always hated lifting weights, okay. But I'd do it. You know, I'd kick it out. But my real workout was I wrestled. A lot of guys go out there and go 10 minutes or 15 minutes. I always at least went 45 minutes or 60 minutes. That was my workout. And then I drank you know, 10 beers, and then I'd go do it the next night and sweat it all out. So.
Okay.
Did you meet with the other wrestlers, like, and practice what you were going to do?
No.
No.
You
kidding
me?
So no one really
knew? No, there was no practice. Not my day. Okay. My day, it was all ad lib.
Okay.
We knew because the promoter said, well, I want this guy to go over tonight, means win tonight. Or Greg, just put him over somehow. You don't have to get beat 1, 2, 3, or just get disqualified or something. So, but I would never plan my match out. I would never talk, say, oh, we're going to do this spot and this spot. I couldn't do that. First of all, I couldn't remember it. So it was all ad lib out there. I would talk to him in the ring, but and I was the ring general. I told him what I wanted to do. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it was a work in progress, so.
Yeah, and what about injuries? Did you have a lot of injuries?
Not really. Big injury I had, and I was over 50 years old when this happened. It was a car that they had in Chicago at a soccer stadium, and I was coming out of the ring, and the step broke, so I broke, or I tore my quad almost 95% off my knee.
Oof.
So that was bad. It took 2 years to heal.
So that wasn't even like fighting in the ring?
No, it was just coming out of the ring.
Wow.
So I sued, but you know, it was really hard. I drove a car with my legs straight for a year, and I finally got back into the ring. That was my challenge.
Yeah. My other big question, where'd you come up with the hammer?
That's a loaded question. But actually, I used to wrestle.
This is a family show.
I got that by accident. Actually, I used to drape the guys over the top rope, and I'd hit them with this big sledgehammer, you know, a big forearm. And I also dropped the elbow, which kind of looks like iron and hammer, sort of. Yeah. But the announcer started calling, here comes the hammer, so it just kind of stuck. And then when I came to WWF, they put it right in my name, so.
Very cool.
That's cool.
That's cool.
Okay. Can you talk about your dad a little bit, Johnny Valentine, because he was everything to you, and as our resident wrestling expert here, Kenneth Beckerman, said he's probably one of the greatest, if not the greatest wrestler who ever lived. And one time, you were listed on the marquee as brothers.
Right. Well, there was a wrestler named Lou Thesz, the baddest ass wrestler ever. And he, you know, there's a lot of guys getting into pro wrestling that really don't know how to shoot wrestle or NCAA wrestle, right? But this guy was an Olympic everything. He was the ultimate wrestler, Lou Thesz. He said in his biography that Johnny Valentine was the toughest son of a bitch in the world and had the hardest, strongest jab. And there was this shooter in Los Angeles, and I forget his name. I should know his name, but I can't remember. They wanted Johnny Valentine to beat him because he was beat the champ, and the guy goes, I'm not doing a job, which means I'm not losing, to Johnny Valentine. You know, this guy was a shooter and everything. So my dad just kind of followed him into the corner. It was on Channel 13 KCOP in Los Angeles. My dad followed him in the corner. When he turned around, he nailed him and broke his jaw just like that. Boom.
Wow. For real?
For real.
For real.
Yeah. So my dad was just tough as nails. He was the ultimate ribber. Ribbing, I mean, he played practical jokes.
Uh-huh.
They weren't too practical, but they were really gross, a lot of them. But he was known for that. He was just, he was mean, but he was a great person, too. So
he tried to dissuade you from going into wrestling, didn't he?
Yeah, well, I went down and spent 3 months with him in Texas, and on the road, I was going to college in Seattle, and he brought me down. And so I spent 3 to 4 months on the road with him. I didn't want to go back to college. And I sat at ringside and watched him wrestle Fritz Farner, Eric Wahoo McDaniel, all these guys. And I go, man, that's just fantastic. I had no idea it was a work or was anything was set up. I watched my dad. I go, oh my God, this is for real. I'd watch some of the other stuff, and I, you know, that was all fluff. But so I kept bagging my dad that I wanted to be a wrestler, and he said, "Well, you're not big enough." Well, I was, you know, I was about 5'11", 190 pounds. I wasn't really big enough then. And yeah, not big enough. You need. But finally, I talked him into it, and he sent me to Calgary, Alberta. And you know, it was took a while, but I got there.
You were with Hart up there, right?
Yeah, Stu Hart.
Okay, okay. Was he related to the other Harts?
Well, that was he was the father of all the Harts. Okay. Bret Hart.
Okay.
Owen Hart, and all the whole huge. Okay. He had 13 kids, actually.
Wow.
And 30 cats.
Wow. 30. Wow. 30
kids and 30 cats.
Right. 30
messy
cats.
House.
Yeah. All right. Moving on to Chris.
Okay.
You're a four-time Rutgers All-American and in javelin, and a lot of people don't know track and field. They know football, but they should know track and field. But can you talk a little bit about the intensity of your field, the working out, the whole package of all you do?
Yeah, absolutely. Javelin throwers are all around great athletes. You got to have the explosion in the arm. You got to have the coordination to run down a runway. You got to have the strength, the speed, the mobility, the finesse. So it's really just like you're compacting all these different aspects of an athlete and making it into one. And the training that, you know, requires that all of those things together is a lot. You know, it's strength training. It's speed work. It's, you know, we lift like shot putters and we run like sprinters.
Wow.
It's interesting.
Wow,
you
that
know?
Is
so,
interesting.
So it's a whole different. It's a lot of different areas of training combined into one, and it's like a full circle. You know, each week I hit different. Each day I hit my different day of training for my certain thing I want to work on, and each week it's just. It's the next cycle, and I kind of hit everything once or twice in 1 week. So it's just covering everything.
In a typical day, how long would you be in the gym?
Well, I usually practice are so different each day because of how
right.
javelin is and the focus on different things. But usually I show up to the training room about an hour before practice starts. I'll do all of my prehab stuff, warm my arm up, stretch, do everything I need to do. Then I'll be in practice. Throwing sessions can last like two hours sometimes, just to go through all of the med balls and everything else first, and then you're hitting the throwing. And preferably you want javelin throwing sessions to be shorter, because that means you had a short, productive throwing session. But sometimes if they're lasting a little longer, you're kind of just you're throwing too much. But mm-hmm. I try to keep it within like 2 hours, and then often after I throw, I end up lifting. My scheduled lift with my strength coach is probably another hour and a half.
Wow.
And then I go back into the training room, ice bath, and do all my post-hab practice things. And
how many days a week?
Six.
6 days a week like that?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's a lot of discipline.
Oof. Yeah.
It's a lot.
If it's one thing I have, it's definitely discipline.
Wow.
Yeah. I hate skipping out on one thing, because if I skip out on one thing, it mentally messes me up. I'm like, I missed something. Like, and you know, I never wanted, like, I hate missing out on something. So I always want to get everything done, everything I need to do the right and effective way.
Yeah. Do you guys, all of you, do you guys get, like, endorphin highs?
I'm sure when we're competing,
you get high on endorphins to make you feel good.
Right?
Yeah. Sure.
Yeah,
sure.
You do.
Oh yeah.
When you're working
after
out.
After I get out of the ring and wrestle for an hour and I come back, I'm good for a whole day. Just that feeling.
That feeling.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Especially afterwards, you know.
Your adrenaline's just running so high for so long.
It's just amazing thing, and the whole institution of. Like, I have a trainer as a septuagenarian. We're going to touch on that a lot.
Thanks.
Whatever. It is what it is.
You're right.
So I have a trainer. So Monday, I'm in a gym 2 hours and 45 minutes. I mean, that's a lot. for septuagenarian. That's a lot, but when I finish with that, man, do I feel good.
Yeah. Sure. No.
I find it interesting, like, with me, I'm in a runway. I usually have six throws per competition. I'm in a runway for about 15 seconds max. You're in a wrestling match for however long, or you're at practice for, and you're wrestling straight for an hour. But with Casey, I find it interesting because you have 90 minutes to play with full focus as a goalkeeper, and it's like you got to really be able to control that those like endorphin high and kind of channel it into a focus. So I find like that, like another thing is, you know, like golfing, it's like it's all similar because like you have to be so laser focused within 90 minutes. It's like, because after games, I pick her up and she's like, she's half exhausted and half just like amped up. You know what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely. I think in matches especially, I'm constantly checking in with myself, where's my energy at? Does my energy need to be picked up or do I need to bring it down a bit because I'm too revved up? So throughout the game, I'll find a person on the field that maybe I need to be at their energy. And I'll look at them and like, okay, let me get to their level. They're, you know, the team, they're hyping the team up. They're cheering the team on. And so I'll look to them and that will help raise my energy. Or I may be too, you know, revved up and I need to be calm, focused, but also in control of my body. So it's just always checking in with yourself,
you
especially
have a
in
tough,
matches.
It's a tough position. Because when they're down on the other end,
you know,
you're watching the birds and the bees up there.
Absolutely not. When they're down the other end, I'm already seeing what the play could develop to. So as a goalkeeper, you need to be constantly adjusting.
What do you do physically?
Yeah, physically. If it's a cold day,
you can't just stand
there. I'm moving. Yeah. Actually, if I wear a GPS monitor on the back of my sports bra, and it will say sometimes I cover 4 to 5 miles in one match. Now, it's walk and not running necessarily, but just pacing, following
right?
the game. It's insane. But as a goalkeeper, I cover that much ground because of how I need to stay involved and connected to my defenders. Because if there's too much of a gap between the defenders and me, then the ball is, there's a big space for that ball to get through. And so I have to be ready to pounce on it.
Yeah, that's a big goalie to protect. It's so big.
Yeah, for sure. And as a goalkeeper, you see the whole field, so you need to be constantly communicating because I see everything in front of me. So I can help the people organize and tell them where they need to be or tell them what they should be doing because I can see everything from the back.
Wow.
You got signals and all kinds of stuff to.
Yeah, when it's really loud and there's, you know, 10,000, 20,000, it's hard to get people's attention. But anything, like if they're just giving me a thumbs up, I know they heard me. And if I say something to my back line, they're able to relay that message forward to the forwards, to the midfielders. So it's kind of a chain of communication.
How many people come to a match
in France? I had no
idea. In France, it was different. Dependent who we played, I would say the fans in NWSL, the league I play in now, they have the sport is growing so much, and we go to play in Portland. There's 20,000 plus people at the game.
Wow!
Yeah.
Crazy.
So it's the sport is really taken off, and people are coming around it and gathering together, and they love to come watch women's soccer, and so it's an exciting time to be a part of the sport.
Wow! It really is.
Yeah.
Wow. How did you start with Javelin? What else? Anything else that? Because I look at you, I see quarterback.
Yeah, I was a quarterback.
Were you?
Yeah, I was a quarterback in high school. I actually started throwing javelin when I was 5 years old. My dad was he threw in college. He threw post collegiately. He was in the 80 Olympic trials. So he would coach me 5 years old. I came back from played soccer as well. He come back from a game and he puts this little stick in my hand. He's like, throw this thing. And I started throwing it. And I liked it. You know, I threw things. Like, it was just anything he put in my hand, I was throwing really far, naturally. But javelin, I enjoyed it. I felt naturally. I just really gravitated to it. And, yeah, my dad coached me up until college. So, but, yeah, I played high school football, freshman, sophomore, junior year, senior year. I stopped playing football I didn't want to get hurt from the schools recruiting me for a track. Wasn't worth it, you know. But I do miss football a lot. I miss it so much, and I wanted to walk on the Rutgers football team when I was a sophomore. My track coach found out, and he didn't want me to. So it was a whole ordeal. But you know, I love football. I love watching it. But javelin has helped me, and been successful in it, and you know, just taking it, running with it.
Okay. You never played football?
No.
No. Okay. No.
Played a little. Actually, was a fullback.
You know, well, I did play a little bit, but I.
Oh, okay.
I took wrestling in high school, and then I played some baseball.
Did you actually wrestle in high school? You know,
yeah.
Competitively?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So before you.
Wasn't that good, though. Wasn't that good. It was, you know, because I was heavy. I was a heavyweight and had to wrestle these real heavy, fat guys, you know.
So I wanted to ask you, because I know you wrote a really beautiful article that we do have on our website, if anybody wanted to see it. There's an article about you, and I know that something happened in your junior year, correct? Now,
yep.
I love that when you did your bio, you didn't mention that, so you don't make that, you don't define yourself with that, but you want to share some of that?
Sure, yeah.
Okay. Oh,
first, Calvin brought it back to life. A couple months ago, I had written it when it was all happening, and Calvin happened to publish it and bring it back to life, which I'm, you know, really happy and fortunate about. When I was a junior in college, I was at the Penn Relay meet, and which is a pretty big prestigious meet in track and field. And on my last throw, the kid before me beat me, and I had to beat him. I was a last thrower, so I had to beat him on my last throw. And when you win, you get this really nice gold watch that I've been competing at Penn Relays for years. I never got the gold watch, and I really wanted to take it this year. And I ended up taking my last throw. I won the meet. I beat him. I had a new personal best. And later on, in like 10, 15 minutes later, my shoulder was like really killing me, and that endorphin high, I didn't feel anything.
Wow.
I didn't feel anything during the moment, and then, you know, I'm like, it's hard to lift up my arm. I ended up tearing my rotator cuff in labrum, and I didn't want to get my surgery in the middle of the season because it was going so well. So I held off on the surgery. I competed the rest of the season with a torn rotator cuff and labrum. I was getting like cortisone shots every weekend to get me through the meets.
Wow.
Ended up winning. I still won the Big Ten championships. Still made the first team All-American. And then in September I got the surgery, and it was a reconstructive experimental surgery. The surgery the surgeon did was never really did on an active thrower before. So I got that. A week later I go in for a checkup to see how it's going to the Rutgers doctors. And they found a heart condition that I had, which is a dilated aortic root. And so I'm sitting here in a sling, and I just got told I can't, you know, I saw a cardiologist. They said I can't train anymore. I can't do track. I can't throw javelin anymore. It's too dangerous for your heart. You can run the risk of an aortic aneurysm. So I'm just sitting here, and everything was taken away from me within, wow, you know, a couple weeks. I'm in a sling. You know, I get told I can't do training. And it was a pretty devastating time. You know, everything I loved and everything that I dreamed of doing and everything I worked for every single day for hours a day was just gone. And for, you know, a long period of time, I went through a pretty bad state of depression. It was just, I just kind of lost myself. You know, I just, everything I loved was taken away. And it was a tough time in the moment. And for 6 months, it was pretty rough. And then I ended up writing about it. I ended up talking about my mental, where I was mentally, where I was physically, because it's a good story. And I came back from it. People got a good team of cardiologists. Some of the best cardiologists said, listen, we can work with you. We think you can continue training. You're just going to have different, you know, limitations. And so she and I came up with a saying, same goal, different path. I can't train like the other, you know, elite javelin throwers, but, you know, we're going to make our own path, and we're going to just worry about ourselves, do what we can control. And that's where I'm at today.
It's great.
Wow.
It's great.
So you've been training this way for how long now?
It was like about a year and a half. And it's tough because, you know, at the first point and the first time when I was told I can't train, one of the limitations, I can't lift heavy. I can't lift over 225 pounds, my body weight. And to be a very explosive thrower, which is what you need in javelin, you need to be, you know, you need to be strong. And so mentally I'm like, well, I can't lift like everyone else. How am I going to get stronger? How am I going to get stronger if I can't lift? So my strength coach and I sat down for a couple months, and we came up with a different strength plan to get stronger, just not lifting as heavy as everyone else. We're going to add volume. We're going to lift more frequently. We're going to lift longer, which is why those practices take so long. I'm in a weight room for 2 hours because I have to do five more, 10 more sets of everything else. But whatever it takes, you know, I'll do whatever it takes to ultimately reach what I want to accomplish.
And you're on the path there. You're getting there.
I'm trying to. I really am. I'm just training right now, prepping. I was in the 2016 Olympic trials. I was 19 years old. I was a teenager going up against other professional throwers. And I'm older, wiser, more mature now. Prepping for the 2020 Olympic trials, and then I still want to continue after that. I want to keep going. You know,
those trials?
End of June.
End of June,
yep.
Of 2020.
Out in Oregon.
Okay.
Yeah, so they're end of June, and the Olympics, I believe, are end of July.
Okay.
So
you'll both be there for the trials?
So, well, soccer is a little different. So track and field, there's an actual track meet, but you have like qualifiers, right?
Yeah, for soccer, it's qualifying in. There was a 23 roster for the World Cup, and that roster will now go down to 20. So there's a lot of things that will happen before, you know, June, July of 2020. So, yeah, that's so obviously both of our goals. But
and are you doing the same thing, working out and keeping yourself fit?
Absolutely. I'm in the off season right now, but for me, the off season was, you know, 2 weeks and then back to training.
I forced her to take off 2 weeks. Yeah. I said, Casey, you just got done your season. You are not working out for 2 weeks. Like,
and
just chill.
You know, in that time, I was doing yoga, stretching, active recovery, walks, hiking, stuff like that. But it was a good little break away from being on the field. But now that I'm back training, you know, they say the off season's where champions are made. So it's the time to work on the things in season that you notice where you can be better at. Your weaknesses are the time in the off season to strengthen them. And so in season, you don't really want to test out too much, but in the off season, the period I am now, the phase I'm in now, it's more about test and trial. So I can try different things out, see what works, see what doesn't work, and then once I get into season, I'll feel prepared and ready to level up and improve from last season.
That's insane focus. Look at that.
Really insane.
Wow. It's like
how did you
inspiring.
Guys meet?
Rutgers.
We met at Rutgers.
Are you?
Yeah. We met, and okay. We knew of each other, and then one day we met up.
I didn't know him. No,
it's actually, he always says that. It's actually funny. The first day I met, I wanted to, like, be cool. I wanted to see how I could casually ask her out for a date. And I said, listen, we're going to go to a soccer field because I knew she was a keeper. I was like, I'm going to take 10 shots on you. If I score...
Penalty kicks.
If I score...
Did you really do that?
Yeah.
Yes.
I swear.
Wow.
She's already... I get to the field 10 minutes early. She's already there warming up.
Well, I couldn't get hurt. This is my career.
So
this is what
cool.
I do.
I show up. I'm like jamming out Rocky music on my speaker. I'm like rolling up. And I was like, dang, this girl's serious. Like, she really does. Cause I told her if I make... I think it was five. If I make... 5 out of 10.
Four out of 10. Yeah.
You have to take me out to dinner. But if I don't, I have to take you out for dinner.
Wow.
And
he took me out to dinner.
I
saved him.
The rest was history. we went out to dinner, and we've been together for 3.5 years?
That's
almost
great.
4 years. And so it's, yeah, she was with me during the whole process of what was going on during that little downfall, and I was
what a great
unbelievably lucky and fortunate to have her, you know. So I was.
You guys are the stuff to make movies of. He's already in a movie.
Yeah. I gotta get on this level.
Yeah,
I wanna be twirling around a movie in my hands right now.
It'll happen. I mean, that's just a great story. I never even realized penalty kicks. Wow.
Yeah.
That's fabulous. So fabulous. You know what? Let's. I think some fun stuff to interject.
Would you like to do the fun questions?
I think.
Okay.
And then we'll go back to serious stuff. So, Greg Valentine, do you remember that TV show, This Is Your Life? You remember that because we're septuagenarians.
Yeah.
Right? I keep bringing that word up. Because I think you like it.
They went in with celebrities and they said, This is your life.
So, This Is Your Life.
Okay.
Greg Valentine, here's the question. Before I leave this earth, I won't be happy until I blank. You're next. By the way, we're a friendly show here. We're a family show. You don't. If you don't want to answer, you don't have to answer it. But
I've done so much.
You have.
It's hard to.
You have.
How about win $10,000 on a roulette wheel?
Okay. Oh, that would be fun.
All right, that's cool.
How much fun would
that's
that
cool.
be?
That's
cool.
That's pretty good.
I can talk about roulette. I was playing roulette in Italy a week ago.
Did you win?
Anyways, we'll talk about the weather. Should we talk about the weather? It's been very cold lately. No, I didn't. Now, same question. Before I leave this earth, I won't be happy until I blank.
Go to space.
Okay.
I've been obsessed with
it. You really want to go out
there? He loves Interstellar.
Scary.
No, yeah. You would really do that?
Absolutely. And I can tell you that within 20, 30 years, we'll be traveling to space recreationally.
Oh, come on.
Guaranteed.
I wouldn't go.
I would go in a heartbeat. If I could afford it, I will go.
You really would do that?
I am so obsessed with space and stars and the galaxy.
Awesome. That so I have a bad thing to lay on you because we're all tall. They don't make spaceships.
I know.
Oh, man.
For 12 people.
They don't.
Just thought I wanted to enlist in the submarine service. They wouldn't take me.
I think you talked about
that. Yeah, they wouldn't take me.
How tall are you?
Huh? 6'5" and a half.
Okay.
I was. I think I might have lost a half inch. You know, as a septuagenarian, I might have lost a half inch.
That's what they say.
Yes, that's what they say. So, to you.
Ooh, I am so torn. I have so many things that I would love to do. So, I'm going to go with... You know what always is interesting to me? Like, people on the cooking shows that taste the food. Wouldn't it be awesome to host, to be a judge on one of those shows?
Sure.
They literally get paid to just taste the food.
Yeah,
try really good food.
Yeah, some of the stuff looks good.
Okay. Want me to ask the next
food show host?
Yes.
All right, I'll ask the next question. Five things that you cannot live without. It can't be people.
Mm.
So things, five things. I'll start on this end. Five
okay.
things you can't live without.
Okay. A soccer ball. You're just mad I couldn't say you.
I know. I was
talking.
You have to say five things.
Oh, I have to go. Keep going.
Yeah.
Oh, keep going.
One.
French bulldogs.
Oh.
Food, like sushi or steak. Sorry, I know you don't eat.
No, that's all right. That's fine.
Those are my favorite foods. Swimming, like in the ocean. Like I love the salt water. Mm-hmm. And then I'm really into yoga lately. Like the hot yoga,
cool.
All that.
Yeah.
All good stuff.
Yeah. Unfortunately, some of mine are going to be food too. My first one's javelin because she said soccer ball.
You don't have to copy me.
Peanut butter. I love peanut butter. I love peanut butter.
You do.
I love cheese, so cheese is one of them. Fourth one is probably going to be an Xbox, because I like playing video games in my leisure. And the last one is probably going to be burritos. I told you, they're going to be all food. I love food. All I do is eat.
That's fine.
So burritos.
Well, you work it
off.
You could
have combined cheese into the burritos.
Greg.
Okay. I couldn't live without watching baseball. I couldn't live without watching football. I couldn't live without wrestling. I can't live without a nice big steak dinner, which I haven't had for a long time. And
watching
great movies.
Okay. Ah, there you go. So see, it says a little bit about the person.
I'm going to change that. Oh. Rock and roll.
Rock and roll.
Okay. Okay. You a Springsteen
Very
fan?
Very nice.
I was.
You was?
Until he found out he was a Democrat. But I know I'm not supposed to bring that up.
We don't do politics.
But yes, I liked him.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. We know Marky Ramone pretty well.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're all Ramones.
Oh, yes. Wow.
Yeah. That's him cool. And his wife, we did a photo shoot with Marky. Wow. And his wife was there. And
that's so cool.
We went to his concert.
One of his concerts we went to, and then we were able to meet him backstage. And
oh, that's great.
Yeah,
it was
nice.
My first rock and roll anything, and my ears are ringing for like a week.
Really?
Yeah, they did
your
like
first
70 songs straight
I
or something.
I met the big man. Saxophone player, yeah. I
mean,
he was a big wrestling fan. I went down to the old Lone Star Cafe in Manhattan.
Yes.
He brought me upstairs, took me upstairs.
Wow.
Great guy, and he's passed away now. But
by the way, funny story, maybe not for...
And George Thorogood, I know him real well.
That's so funny, because I'm very, very, very close with Nick Clemens, the son.
Oh, okay.
And Nick and I, because of networking and my Rutgers hat, we met 5 or 6 years ago at the Wonder Bar, and to make a long story short, on and off, we've been working on the story of the big man, life story, bio.
Okay.
So I've been writing that. So I know so much about Clarence and Nick and the whole family.
Yeah,
we did a big tribute to Clarence, and Discover. We did a show. Awesome.
For the first 4 years, yep. Which helped to change your life around, if you get my drift.
Mm-hmm.
We did the red carpet for the annual Big Man's birthday bash.
Yeah.
She and I, actually, in the old days, you worked the camera. I did that.
Yeah, I produced
it. I hate
And Little Steven's a great guy.
Little Steven's a great guy. Mm-hmm. Absolutely great guy. So we have to talk about that music stuff later.
Yeah.
Small world.
Yeah, yeah.
Really small world.
Can we get to the big question? Because I know we're running out of time. And I
we
know
are.
That
with,
was the big question.
The big guna.
Yeah,
which
like
one?
The group question that you
have.
Not
important.
Okay, so then you going to hit them with another?
Well, in a minute, but I want to do something that's important. I'd love you to talk about a little bit about 350 days.
Well, first of all, before I forget to say anything, it's 350 days is available on Amazon and also on demand cable.
On demand.
And they were, the DVDs were on sale for, I guess they're still at the Walmart, but you can find these virtually everywhere.
Sure.
It's a great, great movie.
Mm-hmm. I love the opening scene.
5 years to make it.
Is that right?
Yeah.
5 years.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, not because you all are here, but I watched it 4 times. I watched it.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. It's so human.
It's full of stuff.
It's
so,
human.
It really
but
is.
It's above and beyond wrestling. It's about people.
Mm-hmm.
And about people in professions and about the work that you did and about the misconceptions. And it's such a touching story. And therefore, because this is the season, this is, you know, the holiday season.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
So it makes a great, really makes a great gift. And I can't overemphasize enough. You know, I wrote a nice review about that, but...
Well, if a professor can watch this for 4 times...
There you go. I really did.
Try it out.
Greg, is it your hands that open the movie on the steering wheel?
Yes.
Yeah.
I recognize them.
The ring.
My beautiful hands. Yeah. How about that?
Yeah, and wrestler's
ugliest hands in the world, but...
They look tough. So speaking of tough, though, I just wanted to ask, who was your favorite opponent? That was one of the things I wanted to ask you today.
Yeah, that's a great question.
Yeah.
I had a lot of, almost every guy that I would work with, we would do like a program, and we'd work with that individual for, I mean, we'd shoot it out with other guys once in a while, but we'd work with that same person for 2-3 years, you know, just if it was that good, if it got over. Tito Santana was one of my favorites, and I always liked to work with Hulk Hogan because all I had to do was hold him down and he would go like this and the people would go crazy and I just hold him down. I mean, it was effortless. Ric Flair was another great one.
Mm, Nature Boy.
And there was a guy named Rugged Ronnie Garvin. Was fantastic because I could hit him as hard as I want and he could hit me as hard as that he wanted to, you know, because I like to work stiff. A lot of great guys. So
are there?
I can't go. I have to mention Roddy Piper.
Oh sure,
the late great Roddy Piper.
No, he
We had this match. It's on the back.
Is Roddy gone?
Yeah, he passed away 3 years ago. But we had this match called the Dog Collar Match, and It was way back in 1983. First pay-per-view ever.
Wow.
And I was on there.
Wow.
But Roddy passed away 3 years ago. But he was great. So I'm going to say he's my favorite.
Okay. Now, who was your least favorite? Were there any guys that you wrestled with?
My least favorite, that is really easy for me to say. I was the Ultimate Warrior. Because, you know, he was a muscle freak, and he really didn't like wrestling business. But, I mean, he brought a lot to the table, and he was box office. So he would come down, running down, and flexing and shaking the ropes, and he'd run back and forth, run back and forth. And when I wrestle him, I just stand up and watch him run back and forth till he got tired. But, you know, he was my worst opponent. But he never hurt me because I wouldn't let him.
Now, are the guys that you on the circuit that you actually didn't like?
Like,
I mean, didn't
personal?
Yeah,
people.
I mean, yeah, could would some of that ever translate into a match to somebody you didn't like? Would you, you know what I'm trying to say? Would you hit him harder?
Yeah.
Okay.
But you know what? If I didn't like him, I just smack him around in the ring.
Okay.
I can't really think of a top main event guy. See, you got to learn how to like somebody if you're going to work with them. Mm-hmm. You know, I guess acting in movies would be the same thing.
Okay.
And, but, you know, so you just had to learn how to get along with them. I tried to get along with everybody, you know.
The movie The Wrestler, did you like it?
Yes. Yes, I did.
Okay, okay.
It was a great movie.
Yeah.
It was kind of.
I've seen it.
It was.
And I'm young.
That's cool. I'm really surprised. Wow.
It's kind of like a guy that have been way to the top. Mickey Rourke played that. They've been way to the top, and then he got hurt, and then he came back on the independent scene. And there's all kinds of independent wrestling going on, especially in Jersey and New York, all up and down the East Coast. So it's basically kind of like that, you know, but it's very realistic.
That's what I want to ask you, the reality factor on the wrestler?
Yeah.
It really hits home.
Yeah.
And his character hits home. And there's this great sadness. It was very depressed. I mean, I kind of found it was...
Wrestling can be a great business and a great, you know, a great high, and you can make lots of money, or you can end up in a trailer somewhere. You know, so it's, you know, very...
Mm-hmm. I don't know if I asked you this before, but wrestling in front of 19,000 people, how do you...
Well, I can...
How did you like that?
I can up that. I was at WrestleMania 3, and it was 98,000 people.
Wow.
And the Silver Dome is torn down now in Detroit.
So you wrestled
that was
for
WrestleMania 3.
How did you feel?
Were
you scared?
No.
No.
No. I mean, there's something about 19,000 people, that's big. You go way up to 100 or 98,000 people. All you know, they took us out and they drove us out there to the ring. When we were in there and you'd hear them react to say I'd hit somebody or chop them, you hear the people react, and it was just like a whew, whew, like that, you know. But it was amazing. It was amazing.
Yeah. You ever have any fear of crazy fans?
No.
No, okay.
But we always had anticipation before. I don't care how many times you wrestled, you had a big crowd out there, and say you were in the main event. You always, you know, I always did these, and you always had the anticipation and a little butterflies, but once you got in the ring, I was over.
Okay. Okay. And do you guys get nervous? Do you get nervous in front of, like, you know? Do you?
I personally don't. For me, like, going in
knowing
I'm prepared.
You're playing a big match and no nerves?
For me, it's like I've prepared visualizing before the match, so I feel like I've been there. Like when I step on the field, I feel comfortable. I've run scenarios through my head, and so when I'm there, it's like, okay, I feel like I've been there.
So you detach yourself. You detach.
I almost turn like the pressure, the nervousness into a challenge. Like, okay, this is a challenge. What's the challenge? How am I challenging myself today? And that helps ease any nerves or any pressure that I'm feeling in the match.
Okay. And Chris, when no. you're nothing.
I don't get nervous.
Nothing.
No.
You just do your thing and...
Same thing with her. It's just, it's visualization before you compete. You, when you step in the ring or you step in the runway, you step on the field, you're always prepared.
Okay.
You know what's coming. You know what you got to do.
Yeah, you fall... In scenarios like that, you fall back on your good habits. And I know, like, Chris and I have... We're very disciplined. We're very regimented. And we, in moments, we know we fall back on all of our good habits that we established in our foundation. So... That's what helps us be successful.
Okay.
Excellent.
That guy over there...
They're telling us to wrap it up.
He gave me two fingers. Fortunately, he didn't give me the one finger. I hate those two fingers.
Thank you all of you for coming to the show, and it's been so nice to meet you. And
thank
so
you.
Nice
what a
you
special...
Thank you. Thank
you know, really, to have you
thank
guys
you.
Here. Yeah. Really special. And you know what? This was the best we've ever done. This was so good,
this
smooth.
This is so nice.
Because of these amazing people,
yep.
A septuagenarian and these young millennials. I keep on. So you know, I'm a perseverator. It means I keep repeating things.
Perseverator?
Yeah, I looked that word up before I came here.
I believe that.
I just keep repeating.
Explains the long phone calls.
Yeah.
So
there you go. There you go.
Follow your career.
That comes with age.
How can they follow your
does.
Career?
It does.
They can follow right now. I'm playing in the NWSL. Those games are streamed on ESPN.
Okay.
And Twitter, Instagram, okay. Casey Murphy.
Okay.
But I think back to the nerves and everything, I think these are young kids here, so they don't know what it's like to be nervous or get hurt and everything. I just, when I go out to the ring, I just hope I can make it back without breaking a leg. So maybe that's my nerve.
Okay.
It's amazing the injuries you haven't had.
Like, finally, so everybody, 350 days, go watch it.
Yes, and thank you, Walver.
And I'll see you tomorrow night.
I'll see you tomorrow night.
Yes. I'm
good
so
luck
excited.
With that.
Thank you.
Yes, so excited. We're taking a train. Thank you, guys. Happy Thanksgiving, everybody. Happy, healthy Thanksgiving.
That's my favorite holiday.
It's the best.
Yeah.
Because all you do is eat.
Yes.
Watch football.
Yes.
You know, do a little roulette, maybe.
Yeah, for
watch a good movie.
I live in Vegas, so I'll go down and do that.
Are we done? I see. I'm.